Before finally getting his crown and throne, Charles I Robert made a lot of promises to his supporters. In order to keep their support, he was also forced to turn a blind eye to quite a number of self-serving moves, notably from the Schubich dynasty, who supported Charles Robert for a very personal strategic reason, amongst others. Venice loomed large and aimed to take control of the coastal communes, again, and the Schubich dynasty thought that acquiring the support of the Angevin dynasty from across the Adriatic would be a sufficient deterrent, as Venice feared that its trade routes would be cut off. And even though the Schubich family provided a strong base of support for Charles Robert, rather than fully committing to his cause, they focused more on their own particular interests. Paul Schubich and his brothers Juraj and Mladen expanded the family's influence over more and more of the coastal communes and further inland into Bosnia. Paul, who held the title Ban of Dalmatia and Croatia, also now became the self-proclaimed Lord of all of Bosnia. At the same time as Charles I Robert was trying to actually get recognized as king. But the dynasty's ascent under Ban Paul Schubich quickly came to a halt with the death of Paul's brothers, and eventually Paul himself in 1312, leading to a collapse in their possessions under Paul's son Mladen II Schubich. Meanwhile, Charles I Robert finally achieved some form of control. He proclaimed that under the age-old feudal principle, all the land in the realm actually belonged to the crown, and was just administered by the king's vassals, and he intended to have that right recognized. But of course, the oligarchs weren't just going to go along with it. At first, Charles Robert tried to butter them up with landed positions and titles, but that was getting him nowhere. So it was no more playing nice, King Charles I Robert, and he forgot about all the promises and grants that he made on his way to the throne. If the oligarchs weren't going to honor their agreements, he wasn't honoring his. Charles Robert's first move was to attempt to take back control of lands from the Aba family, which led to the bloodiest battle in Hungary since the Mongol invasion. The Battle of Rozgonyi ended with the defeat of the Aba family and resulted in almost the entire realm turning against Charles Robert. When Charles Robert asked his vassals for help in crushing the allies of the Aba family, notably Matthew Tsisak, almost the entire realm revolted. Especially after the king had also asked for external support from Duke Frederick the Fair von Habsburg of Austria and King John the Not-Yet-Blind of Bohemia. Charles Robert declared all of those in the realm who refused to side with him as traitors. He then proceeded to fill his court with minor members of nobility, notably a few less prominent members of the oligarchic families, thus creating a new aristocracy. What unexpectedly followed was a decade of victory after victory for Charles Robert. You see, as much as the oligarchs didn't like the king, they weren't exactly willing to work together against him. So Charles crushed them, one by one, several times over. There was a minor interruption to Charles's plans in 1317 when he beat back an attempted invasion by King Stephen Uroš II of Serbia. After he secured his hold in the Kingdom of Hungary, Charles Robert then turned south to Slavonia, Dalmatia, and Croatia. There, he removed two oligarchs by turning Ivan Babonich, Ban of Slavonia, on Mladen II Schubich, Ban of Dalmatia and Croatia, with a promise of giving Ivan Mladen's banate. And then after Ivan defeated Mladen, Charles took Mladen back to Hungary in chains, and very soon stripped Ivan of both his titles. In the power vacuum that followed Mladen's defeat, his domain was split between his competitors, with Venice taking over most of the coastal communes. Charles Robert apparently had no problem with the excessively loyal Frankopan lords of Krk, who, unlike the Schubich dynasty, had been more modest in their ambitions. After the realm was finally secure, King Charles I, Robert d'Anjou, had ascended to power greater than any of his recent predecessors. After each defeated oligarch, Charles Robert divided their former lands among many of his supporters, ensuring that none of his own would have enough of a power base to become a threat to his authority. By the 1320s, Charles Robert centralized the administration of his realm at his court. He stopped calling for the assembly of the Diet of the Realm, but allowed for more local government, as he had drastically increased the number of minor and middle nobility. Charles I Robert grew so powerful that he even made the nobility and clergy pay taxes to him. His administrative and financial reforms also involved the expansion and financing of towns and castles, including inviting even more foreign guests to settle them, and thus strengthen their ties to the crown. Under Charles Robert, a new court culture developed, drawing on his French and Italian heritage, creating a court with the structure, if not always ideals, of medieval chivalry. As a reward for his most loyal followers, Charles Robert had created what some believe is the first monarchical chivalric order of knights in Europe, the Order of Saint George, of which he was the Grand Master. Charles I Robert was now set and ready to focus on matters outside of his borders.